POV, independent points of view from America's independent filmmakers. Next on POV, heavy metal goes on trial.
Why do you think Raymond committed suicide that day?
I think he was affected by the music he was listening to.
Are there subliminal duets on the Better By You, Better Than Me song?
Absolutely not.
Dream Deceivers.
In a case like this, though, it's always difficult because you've got the image of heavy metal against you.
Major funding for POV has been provided by the John D. and Catherine T. MacArthur Foundation to increase public awareness of independent film and video. The National Endowment for the Arts, the Corporation for Public Broadcasting, and by the financial support of viewers like you. David Van Taylor, director.
I first read about the court case of James Vance versus Judas Priest in a small item in Variety, and I thought it was one of the most ridiculous things I'd ever read. And I thought it was an example of what has turned out to be a widespread trend in America, which is that people have a hard time taking responsibility for their own actions and feeling that they have power over their own lives. The more I worked on it, the more I saw it as a story about teenagers, and the more I got inside the head of the teenagers. And in the end, I tried to make a movie that conveyed their feelings and their point of view. And I think that's what gives it the power, the emotional power that it has.
This program is a co-presentation with KNPB Reno. The following program contains material which some viewers may find disturbing. Viewer discretion is advised.
Okay, whereabouts was the shooting?
Right in my backyard.
Is anybody hurt?
It looks like there's two bodies. I didn't want to go over and look.
How many shots did you hear?
I heard two loud bangs, and I went out there, and there's two things smoldering on the ground, and it's dark.
Recording party advising two bodies.
Get all the bags, tell them to crank it up. Get all the detectives.
Sparks inform the fire department is there behind the church, inside of the park.
Engine 2 is behind the church, inside of the park.
Engine 4, too. And they're on the ground. I don't know if I've got anybody else or not.
Engine 2, police officer on scene advising we have two subjects on the ground.
He heard two shots. There's two things smoldering on the ground. He thinks they may be bodies. In the Lutheran churchyard.
How great.
He says there are definitely bodies. One's moaning and we're getting a medic.
911 medical emergency.
This is the police department. Go ahead, sir.
They're in the churchyard near
church.
In the Lutheran churchyard.
Lutheran church on Richards. What's the problem there? Somebody shot each other or something. I don't know. Okay. Are you in front of the people that did it? No, I'm in the house. Fine.
12912. 12912.
It's going to be another hot, dry one in the Reno area. Here's some Judas Priest to help you get through the day.
No matter how
My heart is rebellion with James when he listened to Judas Priest. In Proverbs, it says, bring up your child in the ways of the Lord, so he will not depart from it when he is old. I don't know when I lost him.
If you had some problems this week and you blew it, Jesus doesn't say, no, don't come. He says you need to come because this is the only way you'll ever get your sin dealt with. My blood is the only thing that will atone for your sin. If you have some problems, if your heart's been broken, if you have some emotional distress, he says, come. The only way you'll be healed is by my broken body.
I come to visit this place every so often. And I talk to Ray like a dead person. I don't expect an answer. But I do tell him what's on my heart still. I would like to call certain people murderers. I feel that they murdered Ray. Well, I just wish it never happened.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Please be seated. Just to make sure that we're together, there is nothing in the music, the sound effects, or the lyrics that is actionable because they are constitutionally protected. What is on trial is whether there are subliminal messages present, and if so, if they have an effect upon the listener.
The evidence in this case will show that on December 23rd, 1985, Raymond Belknap took this shotgun, placed it under his chin, and pulled the trigger, ending his young life of 18 years. That thereafter, his best friend, James Vance, picked up the same gun, now greasy and slippery with Ray's blood, and he placed it under his chin. He indicates his original intention was to put the barrel in his mouth and pull the trigger. Had he done that, we would not be in court because we would not have James Vance tell us what caused this suicide.
They live in a hauntingly beautiful land, a wilderness of endless rolling steps. That's no problem for the night.
Do I bake beans or squash?
I'll take what I always have.
The hardest thing we found with James is when he first started to be able to eat, there are a lot of things he can't eat because of not having enough heat. He doesn't eat in front of people because he uses one finger and one tooth that's on the bottom out of his two teeth.
According to fire officials, this was the second toxic accident at this plant.
They had been best friends. I would even say brothers. They probably confided more in each other than anybody else. It was a time when boys don't share with their mother what's going on with them.
This is a picture of Raymond. His sophomore year in high school was last year. He was 16 years old. It's the last school picture that I have. Big smile. There were no signs. And I do know what you're talking about. Depression, change in appetite. All these things. There were no signs. There were none. He didn't give away any of his things. He didn't... None of the signs that are supposed to be there.
Is that the letter and photograph you received from James Vance?
Yes.
And what caused you to have a opinion about why your son committed suicide?
This is what James said made him do it. I had to believe him. He was still here to talk to me.
Would you tell me what it says?
It says, I believe that alcohol and heavy metal music, such as Judas Priest, led us or even mesmerized us into believing the answer to life was death.
Why do you think Raymond committed suicide that day?
I think he was affected by the music he was listening to.
Was his favorite band. He went out and bought studs to mimic Bob Halford. He went to their concert, came home highly excited that he even saw him in person.
I didn't like it. It made me uneasy. It made me uncomfortable. His behavior would change.
It was driving me crazy. I would say, looking back on it now.
And we would constantly fight. He said, did you understand what he said? He said, looking back now, the music would almost drive you crazy.
Drive you crazy.
Well, yeah, it did. I wanted to climb the walls. I couldn't stand it. And his behavior would just change. He would become real rebellious. He would defy authority. And it wouldn't matter whether it was our home or what. He was going to do what he wanted.
The prosecution have alleged us and tried to paint this picture of drug crazed Satan worshippers, and nothing could be further than the truth. It's absolutely ridiculous and bizarre. And people just don't appreciate that, you know, we're humans with feelings like everybody else, and we don't all sing about love. You know, I mean, 99.9% of the top 40 in America at any given moment is about love, you know, and we feel that we're a bit more intellectual than that. I think a lot of people can understand, you know, the feeling of isolation and the feeling of frustration that living in the modern world can give you.
I have to change my way of living. Find my blood upon her windowsill. Better by you, better than me.
Now, I've listened to Judas Priest since I was about 11 years old in a group home, about 12 years old, when they sent me away to this first youth center. My brother bought me a Judas Priest album for Christmas, Sad Wings of Destiny. You know, there's some bands that sing about drugs and suicide because that's what the kids like to hear nowadays. That's what they buy. I've, like, put a gun up to my head, but just never, you know. I just couldn't do it. I just couldn't figure out an easy enough way to do it where I wouldn't have to feel it.
As a family, did you do many activities together?
Yes, we went fishing. We took him to Disneyland when he was younger, Knott's Berry Farm. We went camping. When we lived in Oakland, we went to the zoo quite often up there. We had picnics. We would go to the school carnivals and just normal family activities.
What was your kind of music?
Western, the old 50s. I was used to some of the music my dad used to play, classicals, like the Singing Nun, the Grand Canyon, Around the World in 80 Days.
We got an excellent report from the lab this morning. There's a song, Better By You, Better By Me.
Better By You, Better By Me.
You liked that one, didn't you?
Okay.
That has what you'd call pre-conscious stimulation or something on it. We found out what the message is underneath. What's this one? This is Exciter. This is Better By You.
Sandwich.
That's still
Better By You starts out going Better
By You, better than me. You can say what I only can see.
Thank you. Is the exhalation of breath?
Yes.
Is that a normal part of your singing?
That's the way I've always sung. That's just my style.
Is there some effect that has for the aesthetics of the song?
It's just the works performed, you know, the emotion involved and the feeling that you give out when you're singing it.
Are there subliminal duets on the Better By You, Better Than Me song?
Absolutely not.
I heard the word, do it, the words do it, but I didn't understand in what context or why it was there. I identified approximately 7 of them. It's very difficult because it is a subliminal level.
Testimony really sums up what this case is all about, which is subliminal or hidden messages in the music of Judas Priest, specifically in the Stained Glass album. Now, attorneys came to court today fully armed with computers and high-tech equipment to make their points. There were quite a few spectators in the courtroom, and we asked them if, in fact, they did hear the do it or the so-called subliminal messages on the recordings.
James would do that to me. I mean, he'd insist I sit down and listen to this garbage music by Judas Priest. He would decipher some of the words that I couldn't understand and then get mad because I wouldn't agree with him and say, you don't know what you're talking about, and walk out. He got to where I didn't have any authority. He had no respect for me. He treated me badly.
My parents blame God knows everything for me. You know, they say, oh, it's his music. He's into that music. God, that's messing him all up. And I'm like, hello, this is, you know, let's look back at my past. Let's look at some other things that have happened way back in my life that screwed it up. And they're saying, no, it wasn't us. It wasn't anything like this. It was in the music or it's something else. Parents just do that.
This is what I can't understand, is the stereotyping of people saying that the music's making you do things.
There's a band called Suicidal Tendencies. Have you guys heard of Suicidal Tendencies?
Who hasn't?
You know, listen to their shit Forward. Their shit, I mean, their music Forward is pretty heavy.
I got suicidal tendencies, but I can't kill myself. I went into a rifle store,
bought myself a gun. I pointed it at my head, but I couldn't get the job done. I'm a suicidal failure. I've got to have some help. I got suicidal tendencies, but I can't kill myself. So, I don't know.
There was a time before their suicide pact when he was changing for the better.
he had come back to the Lord, as we say, and was reading his Bible. And that's where I get the reference. You know, he was quoting these albums, these songs of scripture, because he would read the Bible and be able to quote scripture to me. And the way he was quoting these lyrics was just like scripture, like he believed every word of it. And that would scare me.
Do you have any worries about the cross-examination?
Nothing here in the family background that really hurts us, that really scares us. Cross-examination, Sue Ellen's going to try to dig and dig. She's probably going to rip you a little deeper than she tried to in the deposition.
I will not tell who the biological father is because he was not James's father.
That's the one thing I would object to.
You know, the man was never there to raise him. He didn't want to be there to raise him.
She can't touch you, okay?
Okay.
You've got the same intact family from the beginning. If she says something I don't want her getting into, I'll object. And if I don't want it answered, I'll be jumping up and objecting, okay? Otherwise, answer away.
You characterized your son as obnoxious and a punk.
I believe I used those words in the deposition, yes.
And you have been told by school authorities that he had a history of antisocial behavior.
Doesn't antisocial mean you have no friends?
Your son was expelled from Reed for fighting, wasn't he, Mrs. Vance?
Yes, he was.
And he had disciplinary problems in school from the early years, as you testified this morning, with fighting and assaultive behavior.
Every time James got in trouble in school, I was right there. I was a supportive parent. I was there to find out what the details were, to understand what was going on, and to take action where action needed to be taken.
He shot the cat with a dart.
What kind of a dart?
It's a dart gun. Sharp dart.
And did he get in some sort of trouble with the authorities for that?
They came out to the house and took the gun away.
What other brushes with the law did your son have?
He stole some money from an employer. And he got on a bus, him and another boy, and went to Oklahoma.
Why did he go to Oklahoma, if you know?
His natural father is there. He stole a pair of sunglasses from Skaggs one time. Got caught. Everything he ever did, he got caught. Major things. There was nothing. I mean, these things were serious, but they aren't. You know, there's not. You're not really talking like armed robbery or murder, or drugs or. They were minor. When they happened, considered them that important.
My mom, well, we're close, but I can't really talk to her about anything. I don't feel comfortable talking to her about anything. I mean, I haven't had the best family life. I've fucked up a lot of things in my family. Ripped off my parents, my brother, shit like that. But the things I've done have been my fault, not my family's.
Do you think your family coached you along and helped you? Like, say, when I was growing up, my mom never had the heart enough to kick me out of the house, you know, to put me out and show me what it was like. She always said, you know, if you do it again, you know, I'm going to throw you out. You know, I'd steal money from her, you know. The next day she would go down, she'd buy me cigarettes, you know, or she'd give me money for gas to get to work.
I know. I tried to be strict on him, not to let him just run wild, but not to be over strict. because I know being raised up in a family of 14 children, there was a lot of unnecessary whippings that we got from our father. And I didn't want to do that. When he was 13, he was glassy-eyed. I said, what are you taking? And he says, I'm not taking anything. So I took my belt off, and he says, wait a minute, Dad. And he says, I'm too old for you to spank. You're not going to spank me. And I, the first time that I remember, and I think the last time I remember really hitting him with my fist, I just hauled off and hit him, punched him two or three times with my fist. And he told his friend, he says, I'll never smoke another joint as long as I live. You know, scared him. Because he did admit after I hit him a couple of times that him and his friend had gotten a marijuana joint from somewhere and went out in the field and smoked it.
Okay.
They were always after me about blast and my stereo. You know, I'd have a couple friends over and turn up the music a little bit, and then I'd have to argue with them. And I knew down in this house about five times of arguments over music. I mean, it wasn't over drugs, it wasn't over alcohol, it was over the music. So I left home. I kind of had to rely on my friends a lot back then, back when I had good friends.
Hey, Mom, thanks for kicking me out of the fucking house, bitch! I gotta be up at night.
That's the best stuff. I gotta
be up. I gotta be up. I gotta be in my house.
Hey, you guys all want to get a party together?
You and Ann will go to people around here if there's something to do and some money to be made.
I could try to work a job and let's go watch TV 5 nights a week and go out on the weekends to the local bar.
Firstly, I want to be successful in life and have a good time doing it.
Kick back on.
He had one job sorting mail. He had a job at Burger King. He had a job at Wendy's that he walked out on after the first day. He had a job cleaning office buildings after they were closed. I think he got 2 or 3 paychecks and decided he didn't want to do it anymore. He worked for Sierra Sids to clean the trucks until he got acid all over him, and then he decided, well, that was too risky. He just felt like if he didn't want to work a job, he'd quit and go to another one.
Did he develop a certain...
I had a very vivid memory of me walking from my home to school when I was about, I don't know, 11 or 12. And I used to walk from my home on the council estate that I lived in at that time with Mom and Dad. And it was about a mile or 2 mile walk from my home to school. And each day I had to walk past one of these big melting iron metal work factories, you know. And I suddenly had this incredible vivid memory, and I could see, picture it perfectly, and the smell. And you could actually taste it, you know, the all the smoke and all the metal. You could actually taste it as you walked past this building. And I did that back and forth, until I left school at 16.
Every one of us, where we lived, could hear what they used to have, big steam hammers in the Midlands, that they used to, the molten metal used to come out and they used to pound it into shape, these massive steam hammers. And it's a sound that, I mean, I can hear it now, ba-dum, ba-dum.
I don't know what we'd be doing if we hadn't have gone through that type of environment. It's bizarre to think.
Probably working, been working doing, yeah. Still.
Your husband is an alcoholic, is he not?
My husband had a drinking problem and went to AA.
Mr. Vance also has a gambling problem, does he not?
He did have a gambling problem.
And your husband would sometimes gamble away his entire paycheck?
Yes.
Mr. Vance also physically abused you, at least during the earlier years of your marriage. Isn't that true?
That was within the first 2 years, yes.
You wouldn't be surprised if your son told psychiatrist after psychiatrist that he had an unhappy childhood because of the substance abuse problems in the house and other problems.
James made extremes out of some situations.
Big deal. You had a drinking problem at one time. You're no longer drinking. How many people do have drinking problems? How many people do have drug problems? I mean, look at the lawyers and some of the blue-collar workers, they call them office workers, that have drug habits worse than the junkies.
Yeah, but they're not on trial. You know, I want to defend myself and you as well. A lot of the things that she said wasn't true.
She has to answer to God for that. And I don't want to be in her shoes that day.
You recorded a forward verse. You sang in a forward direction.
That's correct.
And then it was intentionally reversed.
Yes.
And placed on the album.
Yes, quite intentionally.
The admission by Robert Halford that they placed backwards material on albums is a great piece of evidence. They have denied that for 4 years, but under oath he admitted to it, and I think it's the turning point of this case.
Thanks, Ken. Let me see if I can be
sure. I'll tell you something, arid extra dry doesn't work when you're sitting there being grilled.
Life for us at the moment, for perpetual movers that we have been ever since we were born, you know, life is basically standing still at the moment. And while this thing's going on, and it's a bit of frustration. We want to know, we want to get it done and out of the way and move on, you know, carry on with our careers and do what we do naturally.
In a case like this, though, it's always difficult because you've got the image of heavy metal against you. And he's had a lot of bad things thrown at it in the last few years. I know one thing I've learned from this court case, I'd hate to go into court with something to hide. I'd be scared to death.
People don't know what it's like to have to open your whole life after you've had a horrible experience like this. I'm an only child, and Ray was like a brother. We weren't looking for an easy way out. We honestly thought there was something better.
The lyric line has religious implications that would arouse in anyone in our culture religious associations and feelings. For example, the line reads, "Thy kingdom come, electric ecstasy." Well, "Thy kingdom come" is part, I believe, of the Lord's Prayer, "Thy kingdom come on heaven and earth." And then they end very differently. I think that you have embodied in the phrase itself, in the lyric line, the very conflict, almost, that these young men were struggling with. Now, another example...
Jesus Christ said a lot about the cosmos. Songs like Epitha and Dreamer and Dream Deceiver. Music was just beautiful. We would get power from it, and our emotions would just soar with the music, and they would go up and down and up and down, and it was like a drug, like a narcotic. And I mean, it wasn't just this third night, it was always like that.
He made sure I heard the words. And any time there was a song that came out that was opposite of Christ, I don't remember who came out with the song 666, but he would tell me about it. It was just his way of trying to get back, trying to hurt. He would tell me I was playing church. He'd say, "Oh, you're just putting a show on for people." Well, they might not see me blow up like I would at him, but I wasn't playing at it.
He said it to me one time, and I just flat said, if your mother was playing church and your mother wasn't busy praying for you, you would have died on December 23rd instead of living. And he never challenged me on it again.
We just continue to do what we do well, and we're about to start another tour in America, and we look forward to sharing our enjoyment and entertainment with millions of people around the world.
Ever since I was a kid, I always dreamed about being a rock and roll star. Picture myself up there on the stage, you know, either being a singer or the guitar player, you know, looking out on the crowd with all these youths, you know, yelling and screaming at you and going wild.
Personally, I couldn't myself be in the spotlight like that.
That's the whole thing. Because I like to be the center of attention. I like to have power. I like to control things.
I felt real close with Raymond.
Do you know how he felt about you?
He felt real close to me, yes.
When you first married Anita, how old was Raymond?
11.
Any problems on his part of accepting you as an authority figure?
No.
What kind of behaviors might Raymond do that would require you to discipline him?
Baby cutting school.
Taking the car without permission? Well, you probably wouldn't at that age.
Right, right.
What would you do?
If I felt one of them had a spanking coming, I would tell them that they had a spanking coming, tell them, you know, they was going to get 3 licks with a belt or 5 or whatever it was, never more than 5, and then I'd have them go find me a belt.
What was the purpose of having them go find the belt?
To let them think about it for a little bit.
Clip is it?
6 clip.
6.
And I got this right here, the Spanish Mauser.
All the people that have been talking to, and all those kids out there, and I mean, Belknap and Vance, and even us. I mean, it sounds like everybody that listens to heavy metal has been abused.
Wrong.
Well, that's what it sounds like. That's what it comes across as.
But yeah, I was brought up in a perfect family. My mom's a Sunday school teacher, and I'm fucked in the head, but that's besides the point.
Yeah. I went through a lot of problems like the Vance kid did. You know, my parents did everything they could do for me. My mom was totally against drugs and alcohol. My dad was a drug addict and alcoholic. I couldn't be around so-called normal people because of the way I acted. Yeah. You know, so they sent me off to different psychiatrists, to here, to there. The only thing they could come up with is that I was a hyperactive kid.
Did you know, Mrs. Roberson, that Raymond told Mr. Vance and Mrs. Vance that his ambition in life was to be a professional murderer or hitman?
I didn't know that.
They talked about taking automatic weapons, yes.
And killing numbers of people.
Yes.
And you knew that was abnormal.
It was always after they had been listening to Judas Priest albums in the bedroom.
You knew it was abnormal behavior, didn't you?
Yes.
In cross-examination, defense attorneys blamed the two deaths on a life filled with personal problems.
We had verbal disagreements, yes.
My question was, they made your son, James, angry and confused.
Yes, what child would you?
Phyllis Van said her son worshipped these band members and it's their music that caused
him. I don't think he should get so defensive. You got defensive with James, you get defensive with me, you get defensive with the attorneys. When they're not really trying to cut you down.
What attorneys did I get defensive with?
All the attorneys that we've talked to since this case has started. And a lot of different conversations that we've had. You got defensive with the psychologist. When we went down there to talk about the problems that we was having with James and with each other.
Because everybody keeps trying to blame everything on me, and it is not me.
That's what I'm talking about. Everybody is down on poor little old me.
You're not being fair to me.
No, a lot of times James wasn't fair with me,
and you know, everybody thinks I'm just supposed to sit there and take it.
You felt that.
What? Tell me what I felt.
When we went to the psychologist or psychiatrist, when we went to see Tannenbaum, you felt that James and I both was against you, and you had to defend yourself.
How many sessions did you make it with us to Tannenbaum?
Maybe two, three at the most.
How come you didn't come back more?
I didn't feel that I was getting anything from it. Every time we go down there, it would end up in an argument.
Backward interpretation, which is, I asked for a peppermint, I asked for her to get one. In forward, stand by for Exciter, salvation is his task. So what we'll hear first is, I asked for a peppermint, I asked for her to get one.
Could literally see his mind clicking and bells and lights going up and thinking, they're right. It was great because when I put the ghetto blaster on the judge's bench, I had to sort of lean round and I was literally a foot away from the judge, you know, and it was an incredible feeling to be that close to the guy. Because when you're in court, you always see this guy in the back with his gown and he's very imposing and very dramatic. And it's amusing because I think of the judge like I guess the fans think of us, because the fans only think of us when they see us on stage, you know. What's he really like close up? Has he got feet and all this business? But he has got feet and he wears nice socks and, you know, pants and stuff. But to be close to him like that was a real, real experience. I got the distinct feeling that the judge was thinking, oh dear, you know, these guys are right, you know. I've been led to believe one thing when, like in all things, there are two sides to every story.
You and Raymond are very close because of all the children of your mother. The two of you have the same father, right?
Yes, we have the same father.
The other children have different fathers, right?
Yes.
Prior to this lawsuit being filed, you'd actually never heard of heavy metal, right?
Yes, I've heard of heavy metal.
But you were not a regular listener to heavy metal on either of the two occasions where you attempted suicide. Were you?
No.
Did you ever see the records from New Frontier?
No, I didn't.
It says New Frontier Treatment Center Evaluation.
Yes.
Indicates the questions asked of James Vance. Length of sobriety in the past 5 years, 2 weeks.
I believe that is incorrect.
You see where the check marks are? Under alcohol, barbiturates, amphetamines, marijuana, and hallucinogens.
I didn't fill out the report.
You see the second question from the bottom? What is your favorite leisure time activity?
Yes.
The answer there is doing drugs, is it not?
Yes, that's the answer there.
It's not fishing or picnicking with the family? And then I would refer you to this next to the last page. James talks freely, seems sincere, but is very guarded in his answers. He couldn't think of anything good in his life.
That wasn't written by him, though.
Wasn't that the way your son felt in the summer that preceded the suicide attempt?
He hadn't expressed that to me.
He did tell you life sucks, didn't he?
Yes, he did.
And you knew he was unhappy at home, didn't you?
I don't understand why you're asking me about him being unhappy. What do you mean by unhappy?
My question, Mrs. Vance, is a simple one. Your son, James Vance, was unhappy at home prior to his suicide attempt of December 23rd, 1985, wasn't he?
I don't remember.
There was a dog barking over here, and I yelled at it to shut up. I raised his catching his breath, and he was sitting right here. I could see him, but I couldn't see his eyes. He said he had the gun just clenched up to his throat, and he was talking, with the gun just pressed up against his throat. And he said, I sure fucked my life up. There's blood everywhere. And I picked up the shotgun. I had no doubt in my mind, no second thoughts. I knew I was going to shoot myself. I was afraid. I didn't want to die, but I was going to shoot myself. It was like I had no control over it, because I didn't want to die. And I shot myself.
They keep on patronizing. This world's not fit for living in. I agree with it. If there was some other place to go, would you like to go some other place besides here?
No.
No, just hear me out. Well, there's no hate.
There's never going to be no hate.
I know, I've seen. But if there was a place like
but
this.
But if, ain't a word, really. If, see, that's what life's all about. If only I would have did this, if only I would have did that, you know, things would be different. But that ain't, you know, the way life is. You know, that's all past. Nothing can be changed there.
I took me months before. I realized that he wasn't going to come home. It took a long time. The baby will say, well, my Ray raised an angel. He's in heaven. The shooting, we don't talk about that. Not, that's not a something that's brought up. And there's no reason to.
Holy Spirit.
Holy Spirit.
Help me not pay attention to the externals.
Help me not pay attention to the externals.
But what's going on inside my heart?
What's going on inside my heart?
Fill me afresh.
Fill me afresh.
Fill me new.
Fill me new.
Crowd out everything that is not of you.
Crowd out everything that is not of you.
I yield myself to you today.
I yield myself.
They say we're a highly dysfunctional family. We're a pathological family. James was antisocial. They put all these little tags on there. And the reason I probably don't show any emotions is because they're all lies. Why should I care what they think? I'm not answering to them. I'm answering to God.
The thing I've appreciated about you, Phyllis, is you don't deceive yourself. You've had some problems.
Mm-hmm.
But I think that's the victory of Christ, that even in problems, the Lord has never deserted you. He's never left you. That even when you've had a mistake in your life, you've been able to cry out to Him, receive forgiveness, and go on from there. And that's the strength of your walk.
Well, and I also believe that God knew what He was doing when He made me James's mother.
Well, there's certainly...
I don't think it was a fluke.
Well, the Scripture says that even when we are being put together in our mother's womb, that He has already written all the days of our life.
The Journey of Deceiver by Judas Priest. The figure under the willow tree asked them if they were happy, and they said they didn't know. He took them by the hand, and after all, they fell. They were following the dream deceiver.
Father, James is yours now. Our heart is comforted in that. You've taken his pain away. You've released him into life everlasting. We commend his soul to our Maker in the confident hope of the coming again of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, the resurrection of the body from the grave, and the joyous life in the realms of glory. May the Lord bless you and keep you, and make his face to shine upon you. May the Lord be gracious to you and give you peace, both now and evermore. Amen.
Dream Deceiver. Why did you choose that song?
The reason I chose that song is because James Vance quoted it.
Did he?
Yeah.
Oh, that's the first I've heard about that. Standing by my window, neath the willow tree, heard the... I can't even remember the damn things. Something about finding his peace of mind into the cosmos. Meeting up with somebody that knew all the answers and all these different kinds of solutions. Actually, it's about being took off by some kind of space, like an astral planing kind of thing. I didn't really perceive that as a really meaningful, deep lyric. We'll be right back.
Major funding for POV has been provided by the John D. and Catherine T. MacArthur Foundation to increase public awareness of independent film and video. The National Endowment for the Arts, the Corporation for Public Broadcasting, and by the financial support of viewers like you.